Thank you, Suman. Thank you, Amna. That was a lot of content in crunched in like eight nine slides or so. And I am at a loss for where to start. But let me start with certain questions. Like first, I must announce that if anyone from the audience you want to ask questions, please put your question on Q&A and we will take your question and give it to the panelists over here. I'll start with my first thing, which is, and I'll not immediately dive into the technicalities. Right early in the slides, you had started talking about you're actually working with non-digital native people a lot. When you are working with people who are non-digital native, then what kind of challenges you might have come across in working with them versus working with people who have a kind of an experience in working with digital systems? Is there are there challenges in like training them? Are there challenges in even approaching them to work and help you with these products or help you with the work? Just give us a little bit of a context around that. That would be great. Either of you can take it. Take the question.
Suman,
Amna, you want
me
to
take this?
Yeah. Sure.
So while there are challenges, Souvik, because they are not, the first challenge is they are not immediately able to see what the end product will look like. They don't have that in their imagination. The second challenge is that we have to develop an offline plus online kind of a work Trello for them. You know, so a lot of the stuff happens offline, a lot of the context setting happens offline, and then all of that work once reviewed, etc., then it comes and is kind of moved to the online environment and published. The third thing is, I think they are not able to understand the use case very directly. You know, like, are internet pe hai, how am I going to use it? You know, how is it going to be helpful for me? So to make them understand that all of it that you put out there, A, is for, you know, posterity. I mean, your language gets saved. It's a digital archive that you're building for a child speaking the language anywhere in the world. And secondly, that you will be able to anyways use it in the offline environment. We have what we call the offline library on the platform, where you could come online to save books offline and then not have the internet, but still get the same reader experience. So all of that. And like I said, you could download the books as PDFs and save them in a USB and then take them to your a school where you have a tablet and then show the stories to them. You could print them on your local printer at home, staple them into books or spiral bind them and take them. So you have to make them understand these use cases. But the fourth thing is, like, with all the digital natives, non-natives that we have seen, the pride of the language and the fact that they are helping it come online, and therefore maybe tomorrow you will have WhatsApp in that language, you know, that possibility of it is energy enough and motivation enough to work with them, and it's almost always been inspiring for us.
Right, and if my understanding is right, they are helping you in both creating and translating the content as well as giving their stories, and also in the consumption side of things. They are involved in both sides.
Yes. So they would be coming and maybe say Surjapuri is a language spoken in a area in Bihar called Kishanganj. Azad India Foundation works in that area. So the Azad India team comes and translates books to Surjapuri from Hindi and takes it back to their classroom intervention.
Okay, makes sense. All right. So one general question I want to ask is that how did you decide on the need for supporting multiple languages? We obviously started this presentation right off the bat saying that you're being accessed in 200 plus countries and all, but that's not how it would have started. You'd briefly shared that the start of supporting multiple languages only started like 3 years or so after you opened the platform itself. How did you come about taking this decision? Was there any research involved?
Suman, you or me?
आप शुरू करो.
Pratham Books was a multilingual publisher, a print publisher, and actually the organization was started to make multilingual books, not necessarily English books, but to create multilingual content for the last child. The mission was to reach a book in every child's hand. The the implied understanding is the book needs to be in the mother language of the child. So that was where the genesis was from. So therefore, obviously, every offering and serving that you put out from the Pratham Books table would need to be in the language that can be consumed by the user in their mother tongue. So while we got to localizing, putting out the Hindi localization in 2018, the work on this started very much around 2016 end. So it was never a question for us.
All right, makes sense. So this is a different kind of organization because you already have the legacy of publishing in multiple languages. So that is very much in the ethos, which I must point out will be a rare thing in when you talk about organizations in India. I think very few organizations will actually be thinking of by default that obviously we have to support multiple languages. That's not as obvious as it comes out in this conversation. But then once you did adopt it on the tech platform, what kind of adoption did you see, or what kind of results did you see? Did it help in any way in the tech side of things? Did the usage increase? Did the stories increase? Or was there reduction in anything? Did people feel that, why am I in this site where I don't understand the language, or people accidentally landing in the wrong language or anything like that? Can you tell us the effects, positive or negative, of adding multiple languages?
Okay. So Sovik, actually, we are still going in a very balanced way. Okay. So if you see my slides also, right? I mean, I did not talk about, in Storyweaver also, today, if you open it, right, the language selector is not upfront. Okay. So we are still playing it safe. Okay. So in our known integrations, for example, the DDL site, whatever the last slide I showed, right? I mean, it's given. I mean, it's reviewed by the partner itself. Okay. It's very safe to launch our Farsi localization there because the translations are given by them and they are okay with that. Okay. And that's where they need it actually. I mean, to have it Storyweaver as part of it. So wherever it is sure shot integrations, there we definitely pushing it. Okay, but if you ask me today, I mean, what is the uptake and all? Okay, so I don't have much numbers because intentionally we are not moving it up. Okay, but definitely our translators and those people, our in-house studios and all, right? I mean, I have seen them continuously using Hindi and Marathi sites. Okay, so internally. So at least I believe that, I mean, they are very well thought through and well built. Okay, so in at least next 2 to 3 months, whatever the way we are working, right? I mean, you should see that pop-up upfront coming and I will be able to share some numbers with you.
All right, so what you're saying is anecdotally, you see people using it, but you're yet to measure how much is the actual impact of adding these languages. That's right?
Correct, yeah. And we are intentionally driving it like that.
Yeah, and one last point, because of this whole COVID-19 situation where so much of the education is now being brought online, we are working very, very aggressively with government partners to have these offline libraries and digital libraries being made available on sites like Diksha, etc. Mm-hmm. And which is where we are anticipating now a huge uptake. Because all of our links that go to the government partners in north of India are the Hindi website links. Because everyone, right from the government stakeholders to the teachers, to the parents, to the child, are used to working with Hindi textbooks, Hindi environments. So that's a huge uptake. And similarly for West Africa, which is why the next step is that the site will be now localized to French. It's almost ready, actually. That's the next launch.
All right. So at this point, I'm going to make the questions and the questions that I'm going to ask, I'm going to make it more relevant and make it outside the Storyweaver aspect of things. Just to use your experience to understand what does it take. And the first thing that I want to ask, that not everyone is working on translating books or translating stories, that you have a huge amount of number of stories. But when a large part of this talk, from my understanding, was about translating the content rather than translating the platform itself. So can you tell me a little bit, as a bridging thing, how do you see the two exercises different, or is it not much different that when you have to translate stories, were both technically speaking as well as content-wise speaking, versus when you have to translate the platform itself? What, how do you approach it differently? Are there different challenges?
Suman, I'll take the content bit, you take the tech side of it.
Sure.
So content-wise, yes, they are very different. You are way more cognizant of the language and the nuance in the story itself than on the platform, because you are also letting design do a lot of the intuitive navigation. So while Suman made me sound like this stickler for perfection on the localization front, but yeah, I mean, all that we really do the hygiene checks around are whether the context is right and the tonality of it. So for example, if to give you a Hindi example, in the English website, the tabs are action verbs, read, create, you know, right. But when you do right. the localization, we use compound verbs like padhiye. Right. You know, so because we didn't want the tone to be talked down tone of the platform, mm-hmm. because that's not the language of the platform. So those are okay. the things content side that we take care of, but we are not as stickler for perfection and reading level appropriateness as we would be for our stories. We kind of do not hold it with emotional gloves.
Is the reason platform translations and all are more around micro copies and small text being translated,
yes.
and they are not based out of a storyline and things like that? Is that why you can be a little more relaxed about it?
The platform text itself, yes, it's more generic. It's not, while the content is very reader specific, it is a reading level specific content, it is leveled to a reading exposure. The platform is way more generic. So
And not only that, Sovik, I mean, if you see our translation, right, it comes with a beautiful split editor. So Virgin Story is rendered on the left side. Okay, in English or whatever the language. I mean, if you are taking from English, there are more input tools like transliteration comes up, dictionary comes up, the translation comes up when you click on it. And then you will be given an empty page with the same look and feel for you to write down. So, wo thoda sa easy hai, because the environment itself, we create it like that. The editor itself, we bring it like that along with the required input tools. But when it right. comes to localization, right? I mean, with the kind of people we have, I know how many U-turns that Amna and her team takes. Because first of all, they don't have access to the site. Okay, they take the pictures of it. And I have seen them offline creating loads and loads of papers or pictures, sending on WhatsApp saying that this read is here. Okay, so then they will contextualize and say that it comes as padiye in some place. It comes as pado, something like that. I mean, that read is different from this read, right? So for that, you need to set that context also. Ye menu kaha aa raha hai, where there is this label coming in. So it's very right. different. I mean, I have seen it. Okay, so the story translation. Okay, we cannot directly call the APIs also because there is no context from the APIs. Okay, so they go with pictures also, even to say that, see, for this you give the label. For this you give the shortened language or sentence like that.
Right.
So the latter one, right? I mean, I have seen her really struggling with the kind of less tech-savvy audience that we have.
Okay, so when you say the latter kind, you mean the platform localization bit?
Yes.
That's the bit. All right. So now you did touch upon the fact that there's a manual translation and an API based translation. Can you tell us the difference in the outcome of both, and which one would you recommend? Say, if I give you in a hypothetical state, a situation that here's an organization, think of another nonprofit having their own communication site, and they want to have their site in multiple languages. This is not about books, but they're a website, which is communication, marketing communication website. Which of the two translation strategies or the mix, the third one, manual plus API, what is the difference between the three, and which one would you probably recommend or suggest? Or even if you're not prescriptive, what should be the basis for someone to decide between the three strategies?
See, if you ask me... See, the easiest thing one is to use some plugins, right? I mean, there are n number of plugins. I mean, you can just ensure that it plugs into your site, and automatically there is a drop down and you select whatever is supported by that plugin. But the decision that is required for that application owner is whether you want to give the control to that one, which is translating everything, whatever is there in your page, or you want to have a control, only subsection is translated, some sections are not. Okay. So what I'm trying to answer is it is not a straightforward answer, Sovik. I mean, there are at least the next level questions need to be answered by the product managers, saying that is to the tech team to say that, I mean, are there any such things? For us, I mean, when you're doing a translation, okay, I cannot use a plugin, right? It will change the original story as well. So I cannot definitely go on a API based for the whole site. Okay, that too, when the quality theme is put on it. So there are very specific sensitive pages where people might not even accept the API based. So what we have really seen it working is the combination of both. For example, in French also, right? I mean, not French. I mean, at least the Farsi. So there is something called reading program. Okay. So if you see in our site, right? I mean, there is something called a structured 6 months program that we have launched, where a reading percentage is also measured. And at the end of it, if you complete the course, you will be given some certificates, blah, and all such things is there. Okay. So while the display part is okay for you, okay, for that portion of it, for the rest of the language, for the reading program, you want to be very sure that the language, whatever has been the synopsis that has been given, what are the labels that are given. So this case, it again takes you to a decision point where PLM, I mean, product team, content team, and the tech team need to sit and say that, yeah, I mean, you can use the APIs, but I still want this section to be in a different way. Okay, so you should be ready to give them both the solutions. So
what are the, let me put this question to Amna. Can you tell us a little bit of the difference between the quality of output between a manual translation and an API translation?
So contextually, there is a difference because a manual translation gets the context and kind of then renders it according to what the context is. So we have read and reads on the platform. And these are two different things, right? But an API may get confused and just pluralize it or whatever. The second thing I think is from the design element, because in the manual translation process, we also end up giving a context of design from an offline perspective. And you know how in Indic languages, the space taken is much more, right? Yep. When writing out a language, and it kind of throws the design off completely. So that I think again in the API, and if you have to go back and then edit, then it doesn't make sense. It's like reinventing the wheel there. So there the manual translation works, but scalability wise, manual is not the way to go. It really is not. And especially with features, with a platform like ours, where like Suman said, it's evolving and dynamic. And every feature release brings about, okay, there is a new localization pipeline created. It is resource heavy. It is effort intense. So we feel truly that, you know, if you have a dispassionate view towards the text that is going to get rendered to localization, and you're looking to make it just something that is available so that people are, it's easier for people to work with it in their own language, then definitely APIs. But as you know, APIs in Indic languages aren't great. You have, they're healthier for French and Spanish because the data sets available are great. Actually, just to use this to bring our point, we've been working with partners to actually populate data sets in languages like Gondi. That, you know, through a translation hackathon where 250 books got translated and data sets were created, this would end, this would be again used as input to create a machine translation tool for the language. The other roundabout way to go actually help strengthen the machine translation tool and bring it back to the platform and then strengthen the libraries around it.
All right, this is very interesting. So let me try to summarize this. What I hear is that if you go the manual labor route, not only is the quality of translation high, there are other decision parameters that can be considered, like what is the design? We have to keep the text short because it has to fit in the design and all. And the translation can be smarter that way because someone, a human, is thinking through all these parameters while actually using the translation words. But if you go at the API side of things, you'll be able to scale faster. That's what you're saying. You'll be able to do a lot more translation faster. But another parameter that you pointed out is that which language you are translating in will have a huge difference in the quality of the API as well, or the algorithms that are doing the translation. And therefore, if you're using English, French, and some of the more popular languages, then API translations will be of a higher quality. And if you are using some really Indic or languages that are spoken by far few people, in that case, the translation quality is bad. And then you also added that you can take that as an input for machine learning.
Yeah.
And which now also gets me to the question, which API or which service are you using where you can actually feed this in machine learning? Which technology are you using?
Yes. Currently, we are using Google APIs, and for some of the selected languages, MSR APIs. The second
Bing
one is the Bing APIs, yeah.
All right. So one is the Bing API, and the other one you said was?
Google Translation APIs.
Google Translate. So does Google Translate or Bing allow you to feed translations to it to help it improve? Or is it something else? Or have you been using it?
That was a partner project. So
we're
working
project.
With Microsoft and CG Netswara, which was the Gondi partner on the on the project. So basically, it was a three-way collaboration. The books get populated on the platform. CG Netswara gets a Gondi library and also gets to give the input to Microsoft to develop the machine learning tool.
All right. So there are two questions that have come in from the audience. I'll take that first before I continue in my round of questioning. The first question is that how do you work with partners in other regions? Do you provide a SaaS solution, as most civil societies does have resources to deploy and adapt Storyweaver platform? So how do you work with partners in other regions?
I just need one more context to it. Is it with respect to the localization? Is it with respect to the kind of integrations that I was talking about? I mean, you understand that part?
Right. So this, in what context is this question being asked about partnerships is not clear. So Aarti, if you can just add that, then that will help us.
Because both answers are different.
Right. So would you want to touch upon briefly for both of them?
Yeah. So we can
posted the question.
Yeah.
So Aarti is there online. So I'll allow you to speak and then you can ask your question.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
So my question is about both the platform where I support organizations to produce their own books in Kenya and Cambodia. So the question is both about access to the platform, but also some of the localization features that we sometimes need to put in because different countries have different localization font support and stuff like that. Thanks.
Okay. So if I understand correctly, they need both the answers. So I'll take the integrations part first. So if any partner is willing to have some integrations, there are multiple levels of integrations with Storyweaver, the content level integrations and even the site level integrations. So for that, I mean, if some questions are coming from any of the partners, you can clearly imagine that they're already tech savvy. They understand what is integration, what is API, such kind of it. So we do have integration documents, and partnership team from Amna's side works very closely with us to have the required MOU signed up, and then both the teams get connected, and then we take them through how the integration document need to work, what is the tech work that is required on our side and their side. Okay, and then slowly we put a release plan for it, and that's how we work with on the integration side of it. So currently, even if you take couple of examples. Very recently, we had one integration from the KAIT organization, that is Kerala's state government. So they did integrate Storyweaver as part of their intranet. So they have Samagra portal. So it's a small, very, very small integration which rides on single sign-on. So that is one. I mean, their tech team spoke to us, and then the required formalities were completed and the integration happened. So currently we are working with an Afghanistan partner, which I mentioned during my point. That is also on the same lines. It is yet to get rolled out. So that's the way for the partnerships at the integration level. So coming to the localization, Amna, you want to take that part?
The content localization.
Yeah, yeah, with the partners.
Yeah. So RK, for the content localization with the partners, we have curated gateway on the platform itself, where we give them a specific role and we onboard their entire team. So for example, if a partner was to come on board as a translation partner, so we assign them the role on the platform, they get a very specific gateway to work with, they get a complete dashboard, and from where a specific content is assigned to them, depending on, and this content is mutually decided. So they would be looking at, they could be looking at a very certain specific type of content. So for example, in the context of Storyweaver, this could mean they're looking to create bilingual books, or they could be looking to work with STEM books around, you know, curriculum supplements. So accordingly, the repository is decided and moved to their dashboard. From there, they have all their partner, the translation and the review teams get tagged onto that dashboard, from where the assigning, the review and the publishing happens. It's a completely different workflow that has been created for the partners, and they are empowered to kind of come and use the platform on their own and create the corpus on their own. I hope that answers your question.
Great, thank you.
You also have another question. Please go ahead and ask.
So my question is about EPUB3. It has support for audiobooks. This is for children who still can't read. They can listen to the books. Also, this could help people with learning disabilities or some kind of other disabilities. So do you have any plans of supporting EPUB3 read-along books in future?
Actually, it is currently already there. If you go to Storyweaver, right, I mean, the assets can be downloaded in two formats. One is PDF and one is EPUB. Yeah, our EPUBs have some improvement areas. I mean, in terms of it's not fully reflowable and all those things. But coming to a specific question of read along, I mean, if you can download and check any of the EPUBs, I mean, there is a read along facility already in that with the version that we are using.
And since the content is under the very liberal license of CC BY 4.0, you could download the EPUB and then version it to a read-along in the language that you are working with and use the content.
All right. I'll move on to the other questions that I have. In between, anyone else has any other questions, feel free to ask it in the Q&A tab. Let me talk about budgets. Because you start when you started out, you said that we are working on a shoestring budget, and that is something that is preventative, or at least is works against your favor when you're growing localization. So how expensive is localization? Making sure that your sites are there addressing multiple languages or multiple cultures, and how do you actually estimate the ROI aspect of things, which you also pointed out as one of the points? Should we add support for this language? Will it actually give us a return of investment? Some thoughts on that?
Yeah, I'm not, I'll attempt. I mean, you please pitch in wherever it is required. So first of all, we said, I mean, we're consciously putting our steps ahead on with respect to the localization. So there are balance and checks that happens before we select any language, and based on the kind of partnership and the visibility that it is going to bring in, there are n number of factors on which AMNA decides, right? So, but coming to the costing question of it, okay, so there are multiple out of the box solutions, right? I mean, I have taken the demos from a couple of them. Okay, so there are two kinds of systems, right? I mean, one is the workflow based system just to get the contextualized quality translations. Okay, so which I definitely would not go for, because we have our own studios, we have our own translator networks, and which AMNA is empowered with, or she works with, right? So that definitely I don't want that workflow. Okay, so coming to the application stack and the resource label loading and this one, that is the smallest part of the tech. I mean, if you see, okay, so once you conquer, how do you prepare your data and reviews being done? I kept on telling in my presentation, that is the major part in the, or difficult rather, difficult part in the localization. Once you conquer it, the actual tech part is less, right? I mean, it's only that the final review CSS breakage, shortening it, or just playing with it, your CSS, handling RTL, That's it. So that definitely depends upon the application stack. Okay. And there also, with the kind of automation I have taken, I mean, we have built in, it can be definitely taken to the next levels of the Nirvana state, but it depends upon how much you really want to invest and the ROI, as you said. Okay. So that is one. And so I answered two parts of it. Yeah. Tell me.
Yeah. Go on. Complete your point.
Yeah. And the last one is, I mean, there are some off the shelf, what is it? The translation editor kind of, whatever the example I was giving it. But when Sovik, I don't know to quote the numbers, but they're definitely costly. Okay. I mean, I'll give it to you. I mean, I might not build the full fledged because I don't need the full fledged thing also. I can decide what parts of that framework is need to be built in, and it's already in my radar, and I will be able to build it and use it efficiently with much lesser or rather no cost with that. So it's only three parts. So that's why I answered in three parts.
Right. So, but just for understanding, I don't want numbers here. But let me say that if the cost is 100 units to have a single language product, then for adding each language, do you think 30% cost increases, 100% cost increases? Does it shoot up to 300% cost? Because in cost, you have to also take care of the human effort that also goes in planning, right, doing all those things, other than the products and the tech products we are talking about.
Yeah.
So do you feel that adding a language doubles the cost, triples the cost, or is it just a marginal increase for an average product or a website?
Amna, you want to take that because you would have the
math. Amna seems to have dropped off right now, but I guess she would be joining in. Otherwise, if you feel uncomfortable in answering this question right now, we can come back to this later and I can ask a more generic question.
Sure. Because it comes to costing and majorly the translation part plays around it. So I'll be more comfortable.
Right. And what about the tech effort? What about the tech effort wise? Does the tech effort double, or the tech effort is...
Not really, right? I mean, because I mean the framework, I mean, if you ask me, it depends upon how you have put the framework. How I have put it in Storyweaver is, whatever is the means, okay, you, whether manually translators came in, whether the API gave, I have a central repository and I really don't care where the translation inputs came in. And from there, the automation starts. So if you see the beauty of it, right, it really doesn't matter, okay, on the tech side, and there is no extra cost, okay? So actual cost is on the other side.
On the content side to actually produce
exactly.
The translation. That is that's the bulk of the cost that comes.
Exactly.
Okay. A more generic question from the tech side of things. Have you come across any technology platforms or techniques or strategies that can make it easier for websites to adopt multiple languages? And I'm in this case, I'm not necessarily talking about crowdsourcing translations or reaching out to other people for translation of stories, but the platform or a communication website translation. Can you suggest any tech platforms that you might have come across or techniques or strategies?
Yeah, multiple of them, right? I mean, if it is a small CMS system that you are building around, okay, so you can use the out of the shelf like Webflow, for example. Okay, so it's easy to build your portal. Okay, it's already gives you the backend required CMS part. Okay, and also it comes with a number of plugins. Of course, they're all commercial. Okay, and already I think 12 to 25 languages. Okay, so the localization support is already there. Okay, as long as you can keep spending the money, you can have your portal built in no time with different languages.
All right, and other than Webflow, is any other tools come to your mind? Or what about on the translation side of things? You mentioned Google and Bing offer translation services. Are there any other options that are there for you to get quick translations done?
No, coming to translation APIs, there are many, right? I mean, but what is important for us is what gets vetted and given as a instruction from the content team or the product management team. So currently only these two are authorized, or rather, I mean, have passed our verification and the quality levels.
Okay, so only Google and Bing in your mind has actually changed this.
In our context, yeah.
Do you have any suggestions around the content management systems that are out there? Have you evaluated those? Because you said that your product is built, is a custom developed product on Ruby on Rails and front end being in React JS. But have you considered?
Sorry, Sovik, I lost you. Amna, am I audible?
You are audible, Suman. I also can't hear Sovik though.
Sorry, I'm back. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
I got a call and that disrupted my
microphone. Sure.
Okay. So I was asking that, have you considered any other CMSs or content management systems? Because you said that you've your product is built on Ruby on Rails, so you must have had to do a lot of custom development.
Honestly, I cannot take this question because it's only 2+ years I have been there. I am sure there has been quite some history why there was a clear decision to invest so much on building our own custom platform. Amna, you want to add anything?
No, I'm also not aware of this.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah. Okay. But what I am very comfortable is with, I mean, now that we have the whole core skeleton has been there. Okay. So whether it is new site integrations or anything, I mean, it's pretty easy for us. I mean, for us to take it up. So that's the.
All right. So Amna, I think we lost you for a little bit. There was a question.
Sorry.
Yeah, that's okay. So there was a question that I had asked that effort-wise and therefore budget-wise, if a site takes 100 units of effort or 100 units of budget to work on, to localize it in every language or to localize that product or a website in, say, adding one language or two languages or three languages, by what factor does the effort increase? So think of this, try to answer it for like if someone is considering that, okay, I have my site built in English language and it's taking me 100 units of money. If I want to add another regional language to that, how much will it cost?
Oh my God, it will be manyfold, mainly because of the time involved. And like I said, the dynamics of the platform, making it like a continuous engagement. And also the monetary aspect, right? Most of those APIs in this context of Storyweaver are available to us for free because, you know, that is the kind of the data that we require, the kind of limit that we have, we are well within it. But the moment we localize it using a manual effort, there is a cost involved to per word of the translation. So okay. I don't know, like it is many, many fold. Like Suman can give me the data sets in about 2 days, right? If I were to ask her to call in an API. But if I was to do it using a translator, it is at least a quarter's work.
Okay.
3 months.
All right.
The money is involved.
First, the money is involved in this. So you're saying that manual translation is multiple times more expensive. But if you can go in the API route and provided you can work within it, it will be a little, but even for the automated one, you would have to spend enough effort vetting the quality of the translation, right?
Yes.
That's also
That's step three, but you know, and that anyways, I would have to do with the manual translation also, give an editorial sign off on it. So the deviance may not be too much, but it's still one step where the intensity would be maybe a little lower.
Yeah, okay. That's why the preferred one should be always both. I mean, using both of them. Get through API and then have the review. I mean, it's your luck. You might end up in transcripting everything.
Right. So now, one more general question. I think Amna can take this, which is how important do you feel are vernacular language support for sites that are built in India?
I would say very important, mainly because, like you said, the ethos of Pratham Books is in the multilingual access for children. Mm. So for us, definitely very important. And also this whole homogeneous mass of India does not exist, right? Mm-hmm. All Indians are not English speakers or even Hindi speakers. For that matter. And the lower in the spectrum you go, it becomes even more important because they are very alienated from the dominant languages. Way more. But the problem is threefold. The digital nativity is not there when you go down the spectrum. So bringing the languages onto the online platform itself is a problem. The second problem is there are no APIs healthy enough to kind of work in the machine translation space. We also wanted to take this opportunity to point out that we are working with two language groups, Konkani from Goa and Maithili, to bring them into the Google input translation universe. So we are helping develop transliteration tools using these two languages, working with the language groups specifically, and the transliteration tool is actually ready to be onboarded on the platform. I think, Suman, your release is next week, right? For both Maithili and Konkani.
Okay,
so that could be a starting step for bringing the language, at least having a Unicode tool for them to be able to input into the translation, the localization raw material.
Got it. And as an extension of the previous question I asked, because what I understand is you're saying it's very important, but digital nativity hasn't gone in. Other than that, why do you feel that sites unlike Pratham, who's already aware of publishing in so many languages, why do you feel that there are so few sites that are actually supporting so many languages that India has? And primary focus remains on English, and if at all, some of them actually talk in Hindi because the market size is big. What are the challenges in the process that prevent websites from supporting many languages in India? What do you feel are the challenges?
I can answer the content bit. Maybe Suman can take up the tech bit of it. So the challenges is a chicken and egg story. The input mechanisms are so tough. The resources are so few to find. Even today, when we work with our translators for the manual translation of localizing the platform, we have to pick people who understand the web environment, who understand the design codes, who understand the visual balance of a website itself. So the subset kind of shrinks further. So that is one. And the second, the uptake, because the digital penetration itself of devices in India is so low that you feel you're making so much of an investment, and will there be an uptake of the platform itself in localization? There's this whole chicken and egg, but unless you do it, unless you do it, make it healthier, you're not making it reach the people. And I strongly feel that we are only, the digital access is only increasing, right? It's penetrating, whether it is through these the broadband services that are now available. It's becoming economically more and more viable. So we have to start investing in these localized websites now to be able to be ready for when India is ready to kind of take it up at the consumption level.
Right, and on the tech front.
It all starts with Unicode, right? So. One script using multiple languages supporting, that itself is a big maze or puzzle for us to solve. I'm sitting on some tickets where even for good languages like Kannada, so there are some defects that are raised, some matras are not supported. And whatever has been supported is not proper. And we don't know how to fix. We cannot fix it because it comes from the base of the Unicode, right? So, and that becomes still more tightened and still more difficult when we get into a languages which is running with one script. Right. So that's on the tech side, actually.
Okay. So script, whether the script itself supports, the Unicode itself supports all the characters in the scripts and all that has. And only recently, I would say, the Unicode support and the fonts, Indic language fonts have started coming out. So you feel that these challenges are slowly easing away at this point of time? The tech challenges are, it's getting easier to put out a...
The other important aspect you spoke about is ultimately once you handle the character, next one is the display part, right? So we are still struggling with, because it's not supported across the browsers. So how do you ensure that the script or font is installed in every user's machine? If it is installed only, that browser will honor it. Otherwise, we need to go...
Web fonts are not working well?
No, for example, Noto Sans, right? It's some global. Okay, so as long as you're working behind the Noto Sans, you are secured, right? At least. But you take very recent languages rollout, whatever we had for, I don't know whether you have heard of Chakma and Lepcha. Okay, so they look so beautiful. Okay, so, but we are able to render them on the editor because it's customized and we can enforce it on our editors. But as soon as it comes to the display part where the browser takes over, nothing works. It all becomes the tofu characters.
Okay. Makers. Now, we have reached almost end of time. One last thing that I wanted to ask, you had started very early, the very first line, I think what Amna had said, that we are an open source platform. So from that point, are there things or tools that you have released as open source, which other teams can use and benefit to help translate their work or put out their sites and all in multiple languages, including the editor that you're talking about. Are these available in public domain for people to use it, give you feedback, but also make use of it?
Yeah. Actually, our Storyweaver platform code itself is open sourced. Okay, so every 6 to 8 months, let me put it like that. Okay, so that's where, I mean, the tested and the latest code, which has been properly reviewed and we are satisfied with, that gets into the open source. Okay, so, and it's already, I mean, there is a version which is already open sourced, which is quite latest as well. Okay, so people can take it, and there is a documentation that is being put around also saying that, I mean, which are the libraries they can work with. And even we did a campaigning saying that, I mean, if somebody wanted to take it up, okay, like for example, try it out. Somebody cannot read such a big code source, right? I mean, we even pointed out saying that we are all open, what we are really open for. If somebody contributes, whether we are able to take their inputs and merge to our branch. Okay, so we have even called out those sections, which are very low hanging fruits and which we are also very interested with. So there is a whole ecosystem there. Okay, so unfortunately, there is less participation there, but we are still trying to see what are the other forums where we can reach out and see whether it can uptake.
All right. You might want to drop in a link to us as well on the HasGeek page as well, that where are these source codes.
Sure.
So that the community can actually reach out and use some of the work that you've done as well as contribute back to your work. Putting out. RK had made a couple of comments over here with respect to I think the fonts and their how they can be rendered. Do you want to drop in and just leave it, just speak out your words, RK, so that it's there on the record for us?
Sure. Doto, Mozilla, Google had contributed. So the font issues are pretty much better on the web right now. But the issues are mostly minority languages. They still don't have.
That's correct.
So for instance, unlike India, in other countries, only official languages are supported. But if you are from a language that has, say, 5,000 speakers, right?
Yeah.
Very, very few resources are there to make fonts and to make things. The second point is regarding displaying of fonts on the web, on web browsers. We still haven't figured out how to render languages with no spaces, for instance, like some languages like Khmer does not have spaces. So when you try to render it on the browser or in an EPUB, then we'll see a lot of issues. So things are getting better, but there's a long way to go.
Yeah, I agree.
All right. Thanks a lot for sharing your experience on this, RK. I hope I'm getting your the pronunciation of your name right. So I do want to conclude this by saying thanks a lot for sharing all the experience that you have of building such a large product. And it's great to have you on Content Web to discuss the localization aspect. We are going to do more of these sessions, and some of these things that we spoke about, including font rendering, different languages, and even the editor tools. I'm quite interested in what is the editor tool, how does it make it easier for a person to translate in multiple languages, et cetera. What are the innovations that either Storyweaver team is doing or even outside that exist? All those sessions, we are going to plan out more sessions where we are going to dive much deeper. Like, for example, this talk was very generic, and we were not really diving deep into one particular issue or one particular challenge. And we hope to have sessions in the future wherein we dive into these particular challenges, like the font rendering issue that you're talking about, or what is the availability of Indic language fonts, or even international fonts and all, or sometimes even in content strategy, different issues like looking into the process workflows that probably Amna has set or other teams have set into going through all the checks and checklists of quality and what are the things to watch out for, what are the things to check for. Those, to my mind, becomes more specialized for independent content teams or development teams or design teams, etc. So we will have more such sessions in the future. The next Saturday, coming Saturday, we are going to have a session on AMP, more again, that is more on the introductory space, that that should you use the Google AMP technology, when should you use it, why should you use it, what is the benefits, and so on and so forth. If you would, any of you in the audience would like to share some stories, or would like to share your experience anywhere in the topic range of Content Web, as I said, please put in your proposals. Or if you want to hear more on certain other subjects, please put in your proposal in the Content Web series in HasGeek. So hasgeek.com/contentweb/proposals. That's where you can go in and drop in a proposal, or even request for a talk, so that we can keep setting the series. We are doing a conversation every Saturday, and today happens to be also an exception because we are doing two sessions today itself. So at 3 p.m. later today, Abhishek Rai, who is another person who's collaborating with us, is going to speak with Takshashila on newsletters, like what is the strategy around newsletters, and how can you use that probably better and in different ways, and learn about how Takshashila is doing things. So yeah, that's all we have for today. Thanks again, Suman. Thanks again, Amna. It was a pleasure talking to you. There's a lot of content you've given me. I might reach out to you again talking about very specific things in a greater detail. I hope you enjoyed the session as much as I did.
Yeah, right? Thanks for giving this opportunity. Bye-bye.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Thanks for spending a Saturday afternoon with us. All right, bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thanks, Avik, for making this so fun. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.